हाइड्रोकार्बन, वोलेटाइल हाइड्रोकार्बन, कार्बन मोनोक्साइड, नाइट्रोजन ऑक्साइड एंड सल्फर डाइऑक्साइड, दीज आर द एग्जॉस्ट एमिशन, एंड दीज एग्जॉस्ट एमिशन ऑफ द ऑटोमोटिव व्हीकल्स कैन बी कंट्रोल्ड बाई द फॉलोइंग मेथड्स. वन इज बाई कंट्रोलिंग द गैसोलीन क्वालिटी, ओके, बाई कंट्रोलिंग द गैसोलीन क्वालिटी. सेकेंड मेथड, हाउ द एग्जॉस्ट पोल्यूटेंट्स आर कंट्रोल्ड इज कंट्रोलिंग द एयर फ्यूएल मिक्सचर. एंड थर्ड मेथड, हाउ द पोल्यूटेंट्स इन द एग्जॉस्ट कैन बी कंट्रोल्ड इज कंट्रोलिंग द कंबशन प्रोसेस. एंड अनदर मेथड, वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट मेथड, थ्रू विच द एग्जॉस्ट पोल्यूटेंट्स कैन बी कंट्रोल्ड, दैट इज ट्रीटिंग द एग्जॉस्ट गैस. These are the four different techniques through which the pollutants in the exhaust can be controlled and their adverse effect can be minimized by controlling in the exhaust. Now we will discuss one by one how these techniques are going to help us. Okay, so controlling the gasoline quality. Okay, so the characteristics of gasoline can be improved by adding some additives during refining itself. And anyhow, hereafter in the coming classes, we are going to discuss some standards. What we say, Bharat Standard Emission Control, this thing. There in the BS6, Bharat Sanchar 6th Emission Control System, they have put forth certain good quality of gasoline. Only those gasoline oil or those diesel oil can be used so that the exhaust could be minimized. Okay, what are the this thing, how the additives can be applied? Okay, by using proper volatility. What is volatility? The volatility, it is a property of any fossil fuel which indicates how fast the fuel is converted into vapor. The volatility, it is one of the very important property of the petroleum product, whether it is a petrol or diesel. It is a property how fast the fuel is converted into vapor. And second point, resistance to detonation. How this can be achieved by spark. The spark engines, how the petrol, what quality of petrol? Petrol having more octane number can be used. Okay, as the octane number of petrol increases, what is going to happen? Those kind of petrol will give a tough resistance to the knock. By using higher octane number, as far as the petrol is concerned, the detonation or knock can be avoided in the combustion chamber. Okay, what is the preferred generally? The octane number is, the octane number having 80 to 90 will give better results, will have a tough, will give tough resistance as far as the engine knock is concerned in case of petrol engines inside the combustion chamber. Okay, so generally the preferred petrol which is having 80 to 90 octane number will give better combustion in the combustion chamber. And another point, oxidation inhibitors. What do you mean by oxidation inhibitors? So generally the petrol will have a tendency to stick into the cylinder wall something, and this can be avoided by adding some chemicals, okay, which avoids the gumming tendency of petrol or diesel in the inside the engine cylinder or inside the combustion chamber. And by using the anti-rust and anti-freeze liquids in the petrol, which prevents the rusting of components in the fuel system and avoids blocking of fuels. Okay, detergents are used to clean the carburetor and fuel injector. dice give the color for identification. So how much Nock number is it? How much octane number is there? What are the antifreezers are used? These can be identified by giving some colors to the gas. Okay, this is how, by controlling this gas, this kind of petrol, we can minimize the emissions in the exhaust. Emissions in the exhaust will be there, and their effects, as far as the adverse effect is concerned, can be minimized by using these kind of fuel. How? By having a better volatility. What do you mean by proper volatility? Whatever the petrol which is used, it should be easily converted into vapor. And it should, the petrol should have higher octane number, and it should be added with oxidation inhibitors, and antifreezers are added to it. Okay, so some coloring is given for identification of different parameters. By doing so, the exhaust emission can be controlled to some extent. Okay, another method, by controlling the air fuel mixture also, we can minimize, we can control the emissions in the exhaust. Okay. So generally, all the automotive engines will work. And will give better results at stoichiometric air fuel ratio. Generally, we say the stoichiometric air fuel ratio, it is 15 to 1, but the exact stoichiometric air fuel ratio is 14.7 to 1. Okay, so based on this stoichiometric air fuel ratio or chemically correct air fuel ratio, we are going to decide whether which mixture is required by the engine, whether a lean mixture is required by the engine according to the requirement of the engine. Okay, by controlling this air fuel mixture also, the emissions in the exhaust can be controlled and its effect is minimized in the atmosphere. How? Controlling the air mixture is done. Controlling the air fuel mixture is done by two ways: modifying the fuel system or carburetor to deliver a leaner air fuel mixture. Second one, faster warm up and quicker choke action. A choke, this is the component in the carburetor which controls the flow of oxygen, the flow of air into the carburetor. Okay, so the ideal or chemically correct air fuel mixture, the stoichiometric air fuel mixture, it is 14.7 to 1. That means 14.7 is the oxygen percentage, 1 is the percentage of fuel. Okay, the ideal air fuel ratio is required for complete combustion of fuel. This is called chemically correct air fuel mixture. If the air fuel ratio is lower, say by 14 to 1, that means in this 14 to 1, there is excess fuel for available oxygen. Again, if you look into 17 to 1, it means there is an excess of oxygen in the mixture. Okay. The engines operates mostly at part level. Around 80% of operation of any vehicle, it operates at part throttle. Okay. So the ECM, what do you mean by ECM? The engine control module. The ECM maintains air fuel ratio at stoichiometric ratio during the part throttling. What do you mean by stoichiometric air ratio? That is 14.7 to 1. The engine performance is better at ideal air fuel mixture. Always, any engine you look into, its performance, we can see its better performance, we can see at stoichiometrically correct air fuel mixture. And it produces minimum exhaust, the amount of oxygen in the exhaust gas as indicated by the oxygen sensor. What do you mean by the amount of oxygen in the exhaust gas? Minimum exhaust, the amount of oxygen in the exhaust gas. That means the percentage of carbon monoxide, the percentage of NO, the percentage of sulfur dioxide, SO. These percentage will be minimum by using this stoichiometrically correct air-fuel mixture. Okay, the ECM, what do you mean? Again, I'm repeating ECM, engine control module. This will adjust the richness of the mixture or leanness of the mixture according to the requirement of engine applications. Okay, and I was telling of the engine has to be started warm up and you should have a quick choke. Choke, I was telling, this is the valve in carburetor which controls the flow of air into the carburetor. The faster engine warm up and quicker choke open is reassessing the exhaust emissions during warm up. So particularly, okay, so in cold starting of any engine, if the carburetor supplies cold air fuel mixture, if the carburetor supplies cold air fuel mixture, what happens? Only a part of fuel will vaporize. Only a part of fuel will vaporize. This makes the air fuel mixture lean and extra rich mixture is required. So as to avoid this, what we are doing is, once when the engine is cold, a thermostatically controlled air cleaner is used to supply heated air quickly to the carburetor. By supplying heated air to the carburetor, the better evaporation of the fuel will take place and the engine will give better results at stoichiometric air fuel mixture. Okay, during cold starting, thermostatically controlled air cleaner is used, which will supply heated air to the carburetor so that expected required faster evaporation of petrol will take place. This is how we can minimize the exhaust emission. And another method, in the same, if we continue, what is this thermostatic air cleaner? Okay, I will explain here. So it consists of a temperature sensing spring. The thermostatic air cleaner, it consists of a temperature sensing spring, which senses the temperature of air entering into the air cleaner according to the climatic conditions. The air bleeds when air is cold and this applied intake manifold vacuum to the vacuum motor. Remember, for heating the air, here we are not supplying any additional energy. Whatever the exhaust heat energy, which is coming out from the exhaust, it is used to heat the air before it enters into the air cleaner. See, the diaphragm, and hence to control the air due to atmospheric pressure, right? This blocks the snorkel valve tube. I will show you the figure. Okay, this allows, see, this is the figure. Okay, so this is the figure, you can see the exhaust energy, the exhaust which is coming out from exhaust of the engine. Some portion of this exhaust heat energy used to heat the air before air is passed through the air cleaner, then it enters into the carburetor, whereby the expected better evaporation of the petrol will take place. This is how it is going to work. Now we have seen the how, by controlling the fuel, by controlling the air fuel ratio, we can minimize the oxygen products in the exhaust. What are the oxygen products in the exhaust? Carbon monoxide, NO, nitrous oxide, sulfur SO, sulfurous oxide. Okay, by using these two. And another technique, by controlling the combustion in the combustion chamber, also we can control the pollutants in the exhaust, the emission in the exhaust. How this is possible? How this is achieved? What are the advantages and which kind of parameters to be controlled in the combustion chamber? Okay, particularly to minimize the nitrous oxide in the exhaust, the combustion temperature should be minimum. At higher temperature, always it is a possibility of the nitrous oxide is going to be formed. It will be present in the exhaust. Okay, now how we are going to control the combustion process and which are the parameters we are going to control in the combustion chamber. Okay, and what are the additives are added in the combustion process and what are the precautions we are going to take in the combustion process so that we can control the parameter, we can control the exhaust emissions. Okay, so the air fuel mixture near the cool cylinder valve, all of us here, the air fuel mixture near to the cool cylinder valve, near the cylinder head, top piston ring and piston head do not burn. The air fuel mixture which is present on the cylinder valves, on the cylinder head, on the top of the piston ring and piston head do not burn. Why it will not burn? The reason is that these surfaces are cooled by the cooling system below the combustion point. Therefore, during exhaust stroke, this unburned mixture, the air fuel mixture which is not burned, is swept away from the cylinder. Okay, that means this amount of mixture which is unburned, it goes as a waste. Okay, that means not only it increases the economy wise, it also it adds to the emission to the pollutants. Okay, this adds polluting hydrocarbon, volatile hydrocarbon to the atmosphere. Okay, and this can be controlled by using the stratified char in the engine cylinder and by fuel injection method. Okay, the another method is by providing lesser surface area around the combustion chamber. By providing lesser surface area, that means if the combustion surface area is less in the combustion chamber, at a faster rate combustion will take place, so there is no chance of formation of any HC. Okay, this how this can be achieved, this lesser surface area in combustion chamber can be achieved by having a hemispherical cam which has a lesser surface area, and by having this system releases less unburnt hydrocarbon into the exhaust. Okay, so this is how the things can be corrected. This is how the exhaust can be controlled in the by providing such a system, more system, the less system surface area in the combustion chamber. By providing this, the less unburnt hydrocarbon can be noticed in the exhaust. Another point, the combustion temperature, I was talking about the combustion temperature, controlling the combustion temperature. It is very, very important. The combustion temperature, it results in better combustion in fuel and it reduces unburned hydrocarbon and carbon monoxide emissions in the exhaust. This results by increasing the combustion temperature, we can minimize unburnt hydrocarbon and carbon monoxide emissions in the exhaust. But this increasing the combustion temperature, any doubt we can clear? by increasing the combustion chamber temperature, it leads to formation of more and more nitrogen oxide in the exhaust. And this nitrous oxide, which is found in the exhaust, this adds pollutants to the atmosphere. Nitrogen oxide, it is very, very dangerous to the human health. Okay. And whenever the engine is operated at part throttling, okay, the control advance provides in the ignition distributor, which gives air fuel mixture a longer time to burn. Yes, by providing a control advance in the combustion chamber with the help of ignition distributor, we are going to have a longer time to burn the air fuel mixture. But in due course of time, by increasing the combustion advance, what is going to happen? It leads to the formation of more nitrogen oxide. This is also not recommended. We should see that only a effective amount of combustion advance has to be provided, not according to our will and wish. Okay. And another very important point to avoid all the emittances is the carbon deposits present in the combustion chamber. It will absorb air fuel mixture, and during exhaust, it releases air fuel mixture. The hydrocarbon in the exhaust gas add pollutants to the atmosphere. We should try to minimize the carbon deposits in the combustion chamber. How this can be minimized? The presence of carbon deposits can be minimized in the combustion chamber by having a proper and effective combustion in the combustion chamber. What is effective combustion? The combustion should take place as minimum duration as possible inside the combustion chamber. Otherwise, if the combustion is not going to be completed, carbon deposits will be produced and it will stick to the combustion chamber, and this will absorb air fuel mixture, and during exhaust it releases the air fuel mixture. Okay. Now this is how we can control. Now we have seen three different techniques through which the emission in the exhaust, the emission gases in the exhaust, can be controlled. One is by controlling the fuel, another one is by controlling the air fuel mixture, and by controlling the previous method. What we have seen is combustion process in the combustion chamber. And another method through which the emission gas in the exhaust can be controlled, that is exhaust gas recirculation. In this exhaust gas recirculation, remember, some of the exhaust which is to be exhausted, it is supplied to the inlet of the combustion chamber, into the combustion chamber. By doing so, the combustion temperature in the combustion chamber are going to be minimized. How? We should see. The higher combustion temperature, it results in formation of more nitrogen oxides. The higher combustion chamber results in formation of more nitrogen oxide. The higher combustion chamber, which results in formation of more nitrogen oxides. We have to minimize the temperature in the combustion chamber. Okay, if too much temperature reduction in the combustion chamber will also leads to incomplete combustion. The optimal combustion temperature has to be retained in the combustion chamber. How this can be done? This is achieved by exhaust gas recirculation method or exhaust gas recirculation system. Okay, This is exhaust gas recirculation system is used to lower the combustion temperature optimally in the combustion chamber, and it reduces the NO emissions, nitrous oxide emissions in the exhaust gas. Okay, a small metered quantity of inert exhaust gas is sent back into the intake manifold to reduce the combustion temperature. Not only reducing the combustion temperature, it also maintains the optimal combustion temperature. That is very important. By doing so, the formation of NOx in the exhaust gas is minimized to a lower extent. Okay, and another important objective of this EGR system is it is the simplest form, which is shown in the figure. This is the simplest form. You can see how it is going to be. Okay, you can see the figure. You can see the diaphragm, mechanical operated diaphragm is used. The exhaust gas, some of the exhaust gas by operating the diaphragm valve. So you can see some portion of the inert exhaust, it is supplied to the throttle of the engine. By doing so, the combustion temperature in the combustion chamber is minimized optimally, so that the NOx percentage in the exhaust can be lowered, so that its influence on the atmosphere is minimized. Okay. And another important technique through which we can control the emission gas in the exhaust, that is treating the exhaust gas. The exhaust gas is treated before it enters into the atmosphere. What is treating? Treating in the sense to minimize the percentage of volatile hydrocarbon, to minimize the percentage of carbon monoxide, to minimize the percentage of NO entering into the atmosphere. And this is done the moment once the exhaust is coming out from the exhaust valve, that exhaust gas has to be treated. And this is done by injecting the fresh air and the clean air into the exhaust system through using the catalytic converter. In the catalytic converter, some catalyst is used, okay, which provokes some chemical reactions between the products without itself involving into any chemical reaction. That is called a catalyst. By using the catalytic converter, the exhaust gas will be treated so that the entry of HC, CO and NO to the atmosphere, it is minimized. How? See, air injection system. In this method, the fresh air is blown into the exhaust gases after the exit the combustion chamber. This provides additional oxygen to burn hydrocarbon and carbon monoxide, which is coming out of the cylinder, and converts them into water and CO2. Water and CO2, they are harmless to the atmosphere compared to the CO and HC, and which reduces the adverse effect to the atmosphere as well as human. Once again, remember, in air injection system, the fresh air is blown into the exhaust gases after they exit the combustion chamber through the exhaust valve. This provides, by blowing the fresh air to the exhaust gas, provides additional oxygen to burn hydrocarbon and carbon monoxide, which is coming out from the cylinder, and this converts into water and carbon dioxide and reduces the amount of these pollutants, which will have minimal adverse influence to the atmosphere as well as humankind, as well as the marine animals, including agriculture sector. This is the system, how the air injection system, exactly opposite to the exhaust valve, we can see the injectors are, air injectors are placed. The moment the exhaust wall releases the exhaust, the air is injected so that the air, the more oxygen which provides to combine with hydrocarbon and NO, so that water and CO2 can be formed, which are less harmless to the atmosphere. And air injection system. Okay, in this, whatever the system we see, in this system, air pump is used for injecting the fresh air. Okay, when the engine is cold, the air pump pushes the air nozzle to the exhaust manifold. Once when during engine cold, okay, that means high pressure air has to be supplied so that hydrocarbon and CO can be converted into water and CO2. Okay, and during the warming up of engine, the engine control module, which causes the air to pass through the catalytic converter, where hydrocarbon and carbon monoxide are converted into HP and CO. Okay, how this? There is a one-way check valve will be made available. This one-way check valve, it avoids the backflow of exhaust gases to the air pump in case of backpipe. How it can be avoided? It can be avoided particularly during the deceleration of engine. The bypass valve momentarily diverts the air from air pump to the air cleaner instead of to the exhaust manifold, which avoids the backfiring in the exhaust system. This you can see. And another technique, air aspirator. In this air aspirator, we are not going to use the pump. Pump is replaced by aspirator valve. Some engines uses air aspirator valve in place of air pump. This is one-way check valve. One-way check valve is used to avoid the backflow of the exhaust into the air pump. Okay. The opening and closing of exhaust valve causes variation in the exhaust manifold. When this exhaust pressure is below atmospheric, fresh air admits to air aspirator valve so that the NO and the CO can be minimized. This is how the air aspirator system. Now I am talking of the utilization of converter at the exhaust. What the converter will do? Catalytic converter. In this catalytic converter, a catalyst is used. What this catalyst will do? This catalyst will make the products of exhaust to combine themselves to produce carbon dioxide and water vapor in the exhaust system. And in doing this itself, the catalyst, it will not involve in any of the chemical reactions, but it permits the products of exhaust gases to produce some the carbon dioxide to allow them to chemical reactions through which carbon dioxide and water vapor can be formed, which is allowed to reach into the atmosphere, which are less harmful to the atmosphere. Okay, the function of this catalytic converter is to treat the exhaust gas, to convert harmful pollutants into harmless. Okay, the main function of this catalytic converter is to treat the exhaust gas, to convert harmful pollutants into harmless pollutants. The exhaust gases must pass through catalytic converter, which is located in exhaust system. The exhaust gases which are coming out from exhaust valve are allowed to pass through catalytic converter, which is located in exhaust system. The catalytic converter consists of a material called catalyst, which causes a chemical change without entering into the chemical reaction. I was telling that what catalyst will do. Catalyst will allow the products of the exhaust to enter into some kind of chemical reaction so that HCCOid NOH can be converted into water vapor and CO2. Okay, generally two types of catalyst are used. One is for oxidizing converter. Platinum and palladium are the two catalysts which are used. What this oxidizing catalyst will do, what this oxidizing converter will do, this oxidizing converter, what they will do is, they allow hydrocarbon and carbon monoxide, okay, to go into some chemical reactions whereby the H products will be formed and CO2 is formed. Okay, and another catalyst, the palladium, which is used, which promotes the carbon monoxide to react with oxygen to release carbon dioxide. Okay, the platinum, it is used to convert hydrocarbon into HP and CO2, and the palladium catalyst, it allows the CO2 to come react with oxygen to release carbon dioxide. Okay, these type of converters are called oxidizing converters, whereby two different types of catalysts are used. One is platinum, another one is palladium. Okay, and another one, to treat NO, nitrous oxide, one more catalyst is used. What is that catalyst? The metal rhodium is the catalyst which is used. This catalyst, it splits NO, nitrous oxide, it splits into oxygen and nitrogen. This oxygen and nitrogen, these are harmless pollutants compared to NO. Okay, so once when NO is reduced into oxygen and N2, that means these type of converters are called reducing converter. These type of converters are called reducing converter. In this reducing converter, the catalyst which is used is metal rhodium. Metal rhodium. A large surface area of catalytic converter is coated with a catalyst. Either it may be platinum, palladium, or rhodium. Large surface area of catalytic converter is coated with catalyst. The coated surface area or substrate is in the form of a bed or small beads or pellets or ceramic honeycomb. Honeycomb converters is round and pellet type of converter is flat in shape. Honeycomb converter is round, pellet type converter, it is flat. These two types of converters used both in oxidizing converter as well as reducing converter. The vehicles fitted with catalytic converter in the exhaust system must use unleaded gasoline. See, whenever the converters are used in these systems, the gasoline which is used is, it should be free from lead. If the lead percentage is present in the gasoline, what happens? Okay, this lead, if the lead percentage is present in the gasoline which is used in this type of catalytic converter, the lead which is present in the gasoline, it coats the catalyst. The lead which is present in the gasoline, it coats the catalyst and makes the converter ineffective. Once when the catalyst is coated with lead, the converter cannot perform its catalytic operation, and the converter itself will be ineffective. So whenever catalytic converters are used, we should use the petrol which is free from lead. If the lead is present, this lead will coat the catalyst and makes the converter ineffective. And always one point we should remember, okay, always the stoichiometrically correct air fuel mixture, that is 14.721, always the stoichiometrically correct air fuel mixture will be more effective working with catalytic converter. will be more, not only the stoichiometrically correct air fuel ratio is effective with catalytic converter, it is effective with all kinds of emission controlling system. Not only all kinds of emission controlling system, the engine will give better performance by using the stoichiometrically correct air fuel mixture. What is the stoichiometrically correct air fuel mixture? That is 14.7:1. Approximately, we can say 15:1. 15 is the percentage of oxygen and 1 is the percentage of helium. Okay. And this is, there are dual beta and three way catalytic converters are used. Okay. So here in this type, same thing, what we have seen, the both type of a dual bed catalytic converter consists of two pellet beds, one over the other, and are separated by an air chamber. The pellets coated with three-way catalyst produces NO into N2N oxygen is provided on the upper bed. It also helps oxidize HC into HC and CO, hydrocarbon and carbon monoxide into water vapor and carbon dioxide. The tie lower bed acts two-way catalyst and oxidizes the remaining hydrocarbon and carbon monoxide. When the vehicle is warming up, the air pump supplies secondary air to the air chamber to separate the upper and lower beds. This is how we can control the emission of the vehicle in the exhaust, the emission gases in the exhaust of any automotive vehicle. What are the four methods? One is by controlling the fuel, by controlling the air fuel ratio, by controlling the combustion process, by having the EGR system, the evaporative gas recirculation system, and by using catalytic converter, the emission gases in the exhaust can be controlled. This is how the exhaust gas emission gases in the exhaust can be treated before it reaches to the atmosphere. By treating the, we are going to convert maximum dangerous pollutants in the atmosphere into lesser dangerous pollutants to the atmosphere, so that the pollutants influence will not be much adverse to the atmosphere. This is what we are going to do. This is how the emission control system, we have discussed emission control system in the crankcase. Okay, emission control system in the fuel tank and the carburetor. And we have seen the emission gases are controlled in the exhaust by controlling the fuel, by controlling the air fuel ratio, by controlling the combustion process, by having the exhaust recirculation gas method, and by using the catalytic converter. By having these four techniques, we could be able to treat the emission gases in the engines. So this is how the emission control system works.